Yeah. Yeah, I'm okay.
I can see it.
Good afternoon. That's some light we got here, I gotta say. Let me start. I think all 3 days here, there was kind of a pall over our meeting because we learned on Tuesday of Peter Seidler's passing. You know, Peter came from a baseball family. He was a respected and popular member of the current ownership group. And while we all knew Peter was ill, I think, as is always the case, the passing of one of our own was a very sad event for everyone that was here over the last 3 days. And, you know, we really do send out our thoughts and prayers to Peter's family. The rest of the business, the big topics, local media, our local media situation, numerous meetings on that topic, both specifically on the Diamond bankruptcy, which for those of you who are following was unfolding as while we were here, but also on the longer term strategic plans for what we're gonna do on local media. We had a very thorough review of the performance of our business in 2023, really positive trends in terms of attendance, more than 70 million people, you know, really strong financial performance, great World Series with record-setting gates, all positive, and a lot of discussion about how the changes we've made over time, including balanced schedule, expanded playoffs, the pitch clock, how all those changes have worked together to produce what was a great year financially. Given that it's the height of the hiring season, we did have an extended conversation both in committee and the joint meeting about diversity. We're positive and pleased about the hires in the managerial ranks. We had a good off season in that regard and very proud of that and look for continued progress on that topic. We also reviewed areas where we need to continue to try to do better. We had an update from the Tampa Bay Rays on their stadium plan in St. Petersburg. We also had a thorough review of our international play plan for next year, probably the most aggressive international plan we've ever had, with games in London, Seoul, Mexico City, and the Dominican Republic. And then I guess the headliner, obviously, was the Oakland relocation vote. I want to start with just a little bit of the process that led us here. There was an effort over more than a decade to find a stadium solution in Oakland. It was John Fisher's preference. It was my preference. As a matter of fact, the first trip I made after I was elected commissioner was to Oakland to talk to John about trying to get something done there. It didn't happen. We, you know, a lot of back and forth, but the fact of the matter is that there was never a deal in Oakland. When it became clear that there was an opportunity to move to Las Vegas, we appointed a relocation committee. I want to thank Mark Antanasio, John Sherman, and John Middleton. I don't think in my time in baseball there has ever been an owner committee that spent more hours in a relatively discreet period of time than this relocation committee. There was no aspect of this issue that was left unturned, including what the Oakland opportunity was, what the Las Vegas opportunity was, how we ended up here, and what Las Vegas was going to do for Major League Baseball. I just, again, have to thank them for the time and effort that they put in. The relocation committee made a set of recommendations to me. I adopted those recommendations without change. We took those recommendations to the executive council. They unanimously voted in favor of the relocation. And then today we had a 30 club vote, which was also unanimous in favor of the recommendation. I know this is a terrible day for fans in Oakland. That is, I understand that, and that's why we've all had a policy of doing everything humanly possible to avoid a relocation, and I truly believe we did that in this case. I think it's beyond debate that the status quo in Oakland was untenable. Those of you who have been in the building understand what I'm talking about, and I absolutely am convinced that there was not a viable path forward in Oakland. We look forward to being in Las Vegas. Tremendous support locally for having the A's there. And we do believe over the long haul, Las Vegas will be a great asset to Major League Baseball. I'd like to ask John Fisher to come up and say a few words, and then I'll finish up.
Hello, everybody. As Rob said, today is an incredibly difficult day for Oakland A's fans. It's a great day for Las Vegas. I want to thank the commissioner, who was tireless in his and his team's efforts to try and find a solution here and to work closely with us and with the Oakland and Las Vegas communities to try and find a solution for a new stadium for the A's, which has always been our goal. I want to thank in Nevada the governor, Joe Lombardo, who is also tireless in his efforts to make this work, Leader Cannizzaro, Speaker Yeager, and the Clark County Commission in particular with Chairman Jim Gibson. I understand this is an incredibly difficult day for Oakland fans, I just want to say we gave every effort and did everything we could to try and find a solution there. And it was only in the last couple of years that we began to turn our attention to another market, that being Las Vegas. I'm very excited about the opportunity in Vegas. The fans there are terrific. The success of the Raiders and the Golden Knights has shown, as well as our own AAA team, the Aviators, has shown just how successful professional sports can be in that market. And we really look forward to opening day in 2028 and bringing some of the success of the historical success of the Athletics to Las Vegas. Thank you.
We did have one other action item on the agenda. I'm pleased to announce that the Executive Council has approved the Atlanta Braves as the hosts of the 2025 All-Star Game and the surrounding events. We had a great week this year in Seattle. We're looking forward to being back here in Texas in 2024. And I think everyone knows we're going to be in Philadelphia for the 250th anniversary of the country in 2026. I've said it before. We wanted to bring an all-star game back to Atlanta. I made a decision in 2021 to move the event, and I understand, believe me, that people had then and probably still have different views as to the merits of that decision. What's most important is that the Atlanta Braves are a great organization. Truist Park and the Battery are gems in terms of the facilities, and Atlanta and Georgia has been a great markets for us for a very, very long time. With their great fan base and rich history, Atlanta deserves an All-Star game, and we're really looking forward to being there in 2025. Okay, with that, I'm happy to take questions. Okay, thank you. Go ahead.
Vegas, obviously, just talk about the excitement about Vegas and why Vegas fits in with the Major League Baseball and the A's as well.
Yeah, look, I think that, Vegas is a unique market in many ways. Not only is it a great community with the people that live there, but the tourism traffic is a huge advantage for the market. They've had two major professional sports go there. They've been wildly successful with respect to both. We think there's a ton of fans in Las Vegas, ton of baseball fans, and we think that over the long haul, Las Vegas will be a huge asset to Major League Baseball.
Hi, Casey Harrison, Las Vegas Sun. Just wondering if, because there will be a gap between when the Las Vegas ballpark will be ready, if there have been contingencies about where Oakland will play, from 2025 to 2027.
Yeah, Oakland has a lease. The A's have a lease at the Coliseum in Oakland, so they're going to be there in 2024. And we're exploring a variety of alternatives, including staying at the Coliseum for the remaining years in the interim. Jeff, you want to? Thanks.
Rob, did you waive the relocation fee for the A's? And if so, why did you make that decision?
Yes, I did waive the relocation fees for the A's. As a process matter, what really happens is that I recommend that the relocation fee be waived, and it was then endorsed by the relocation committee, the executive council, and the owners ultimately. We felt that a relocation fee in this particular situation was inappropriate. There was significant expenditures by John Fisher and his family to get the stadium built. It's $1.5 billion project. That was really important. We also felt that in terms of the public support that was available, the waiving of a relocation fee made that support stronger. We wanted to go into the market in a way that the people in the market felt like we were making an investment in them and looking to grow the game. That's the best I can do for you in that one.
Rob, could you detail or explain some of what the report was that your group put together? Were there any hesitancies or concerns about the media market size, about the reliance on tourism, the ability to sustain a team?
Yeah, no, I think that the report covers a mandatory set of topics that are essentially laid out in the relocation guidelines in terms of what's the operating territory, what's the home television territory. I think in terms of the Las Vegas market itself, the relocation committee was unanimous in the view that Las Vegas was a strong market, probably the strongest, one of the two strongest open markets in the United States. And that it had more than enough capacity to support a major league team. The A's analysis of the market was consistent with that view, and we actually used an outside consultant that did a market analysis as well and was consistent with, you know, the ownership committee's or the relocation committee's view, as well as the projections that the A's had prepared.
Yeah, hey, Rob. You mentioned you're open to extending at the Coliseum 25 and maybe beyond. Do you plan to extend an olive branch to the city of Oakland, including the mayor? There's a relationship between you and the city and the team in the city that is not really good. And fans are already talking about boycotting the 2024 season.
I have no issue with the city of Oakland or the mayor. We tried very hard to make a deal in Oakland. We did that out of respect for the fans in Oakland. I hope they understand that at some point a facility deteriorates to the level that it's just not a major league facility, and that if you look at the situation objectively, we really had no choice but to move on.
And you're giving all of Northern California to the Giants. Is that a concern when you have three teams in Southern California?
Giants territory remains unchanged. The Giants territory was not changed.
Uh-huh. And would you be open to expansion in the Bay Area, even in Oakland down the road?
When and if we have an expansion process, every city that's interested in having an expansion franchise will have an opportunity to participate.
And what's the territory right now? How does that divide it with the A's leaving? After they leave, how are you going to divide? Is it all Giants territory, or how is it going to work?
I said already, the Giants territory remains unchanged. The Oakland territory will become an Oakland open territory. Bill.
Thanks, Glenn. The Oakland mayor has said she is receptive to a short-term lease at the Coliseum through 2027, but she would like the A's name to stay in Oakland and would like the promise of an expansion team. Are either of those things possible, or are those non-starters?
It's certainly possible to have a lease extension where the A's would play in Oakland beyond 2024. In the first instance, that's an issue for John in terms of making a recommendation that we'll present to the clubs. We don't even know if we're going to have an expansion process, so I'm not in a position to bargain about where the expansion teams are going to go.
Rob, if the A's have to do what the Blue Jays did a few years ago during the pandemic and play a few different sites, does that have to get approval from the union?
Yes. Our preference always is to find a home for 81. You point to one situation where just playing wasn't possible, and we were flexible on that. My hope is we find an 81-game home for the A's.
Rob, what steps from here need to be taken with this move? You know, are there financing agreements in place, the stadium construction? What plans are outstanding?
Yeah, I think that there's a binding construction agreement in place. Exactly what the steps are going to be is a question for John, not for me.
If you could, on two other topics, where are you at on the rules, and can you talk a little bit about where you are with RSNs and
yeah,
Diamond?
I like the rules in general. No, you mean looking for? Well, I'm
dropping down potential.
Oh, the potential. Yeah. Look, I think the most important thing on rules is that the owners, the players, the umpires have an openness to revisiting changes that we've made or other rules, number one. And I'm hopeful that process becomes more collaborative. I know there are some rule changes that are been discussed in the committee that were actually player suggestions. I take that as a huge positive. And I'm hopeful that with some further discussion, the things that are out on the table, we're able to reach a consensus.
Take one last one.
Oh, the locals. Yeah, I'm sorry.
RSNs.
Yeah. Look, this is a very, very complicated situation. Our primary goal at this point is certainty. I know it kind of came off without a hitch in the sense that, you know, San Diego was terminated, Arizona was rejected. We were able to step in and broadcast those games. Fans were not, you know, disadvantaged in any way. As a matter of fact, our reach was better because we had a digital product available. To undertake another summer where we have 12 teams at risk, given that the financial situation of the RSNs, the Diamond RSNs has further deteriorated, is not an appealing prospect. You know, it's one thing to pick up one or two. Picking up 12 with no notice is a Herculean feat. We need to know who they want to keep, who they have the ability to pay, who they don't want to keep, so that we can make other arrangements for those teams now so that our fans are not disrupted.
Last one.
Rob, certainly the A's fans have been outspoken in their opinion of John Fisher. Do you believe that he has been a good owner for Major League Baseball?
You know, it's interesting, Jeff. One of the things that you have to do in the relocation committee is you looked at the history of the franchise. I think from my years are going to be a little off, and Mr. Halem will, I'm sure, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think from 2020 to from 2000 to 2022, that franchise won the sixth most games in Major League Baseball. I think they made the playoffs 11 times. You can look around at a lot of teams that did not achieve those kinds of numbers. I understand the fans' reaction to, you know, what happened in 2022 in terms of the moves that were made. I also understand that when you play in a substandard facility with, you know, fan support that is not as strong as what we have in some other markets, that it affects your economics and what you can afford to do. So my answer is, over the long haul, yes, I think he's been a good owner. All right, thank you.